Good morning. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship here at Asylum Hill Congregational Church, an open and affirming congregation in the United Church of Christ. My name is Reverend Jordan Bucey, and I am your minister for early life. I want you all to know, you get bonus points today for being here, for coming out in the rain. So just in case you need like a punch card punched, you get extra points. All of you who are live streaming, we are so thankful that you are also joining us wherever you are in the world. Whether you are live streaming right this moment or catching the recording later in the week, thank you for being a part of this worship service. We are only who we are because each and every one of you have made the decision to be a part of it. So thank you. Friends, we always invite you to check out our website, ahcc.org, where you can send in a prayer request. We want to know what's on your heart. We want to be praying for you and with you. While you're on the website this morning, please go ahead and sign in. We want to know who you are and where you are so that we can stay connected. There's also a place where you can check off if you want to be contacted by one of the pastors. So if you would like a reach out, please sign in and let us know. But while you're on that website, please make sure you're checking out our calendar. We're just a few weeks away from starting our new program year. We, your staff and clergy, are so excited to share the theme for this year and all of the exciting events and programs that we are offering for you all. So please make sure that you're, go ahead and bookmark the calendar so that you can check in often and see what is going on, because we don't want you to miss anything. Today at 12 noon, folks, rain or shine, we are out in that parking lot serving our free weekly community meal, where we serve 150 meals to our neighbors in the Asylum Hill neighborhood. And we want you to be a part of it. Even if you are unable to physically volunteer, there are other ways to be a part of it. We are always in need of donations, bottled water, individually packaged snacks, and many of you bake cookies and brownies so that we can also give those out to our neighbors. If you have any questions about our community meals, please just call the front office or reach out to Reverend Sonia Green. I invite you now to just get comfortable. You are here. You are a part of this service. Take a deep breath. Maybe plant your feet firmly on the ground. Relax your shoulders. Unclench your jaw. And just remember that there is nowhere in the world that you need to be than right here. Let us now rise in body and or spirit to join together in our call to worship.
We gather in the presence of the one who breathes life into all creation. We sing praises and breath God's goodness. We try to remember that we are part of mercy and majesty of the world. We are welcomed into the comfort of God's embrace, deserving all goodness our Creator offers. Leaving no one outside. Together we reflect the fullness of God's love. Together we bring God's love into the world. Let us worship the living God, who breathes us life and light. Amen.
Thank you.
I know that all of you probably have a favorite hymn. This is my favorite hymn. And I am so thankful that we were able to sing it together today. And I just want to say to you my favorite line. We have been sung throughout all of history, called to be light to the whole human race. How beautiful is that? Friends, in this moment, as we turn to our neighbors to pass the peace of Christ, really what we're doing is embodying those two lines. You have been sung throughout all of history, called to be light to the whole human race. Let us now turn to our neighbors and pass that light and peace to each other. Okay, everyone. Even if this is your first Sunday, you may have noticed something a little different about the chancel over the past few weeks, but especially this morning. We have the honor of blessing these backpacks that you all have so beautifully collected and donated so that we can give them to the children at West Middle School right down the street. So, it may not look like a lot, but guess what? We also collected the funds to be able to purchase backpacks. And I am so excited to say to you all that our goal is pretty lofty. Our goal was 200 backpacks. Congratulations. We collected 200 backpacks, and they're actually still coming in, so thank you all so much. As we bless these backpacks, I want you, whether you yourself are getting ready to start school, or you have a child or a grandchild, a neighbor, a friend who's getting ready to start school, I want you to think about each and every one of the young people who are going to get to pack these up with all of their books and supplies and walk in on that first day of school confident and knowing that they are cared for and loved. In this moment, I invite you to join me in our blessing of the backpack. As we prepare for the beginning of a new school year, we bless these backpacks. We pray that they will be a blessing to the students who will carry them. Our God is a God of new beginnings and new creations. God calls these new beginnings good, and we pray that each student knows that they are fully loved as they use these backpacks. God of love, we ask for your continued blessing on all of the students preparing for the new school year. Surround them with comfort and protection. Thank you for inviting us into their lives by allowing us to give of these backpacks. It is a blessing to be a blessing. Amen. So as is our custom, each week during our summer series, The Gospel According to Broadway, I'm going to give a little introduction to our musical for today. Our musical today is Dear Evan Hansen. Opening on Broadway in December of 2016, the show follows a high school senior with severe social anxiety named Evan Hansen. Now, the show received critical acclaim from audiences and critics, and at the 71st Tony Awards, it was nominated for 9 awards, winning 6, including Best Musical, Best Book, Best Score, Best Actor, and Best Featured Actress. In 2021, the show was adapted to film, where Ben Platt, who played Evan Hansen in the original Broadway cast, reprised his role for the big screen. So, a few notes and a trigger warning before we move on in our worship service together. Dear Evan Hansen is the show that I have been most excited about and terrified about. We actually discussed doing it last summer when we did the first Gospel According to Broadway run, but decided it just wasn't the right time. But here we are today for just such a time as this. Friends, I am going to be very vulnerable with you all this morning. Many of you already know about my own mental health journey over the past 17 years. And I am very open about my experience because I pray that it will offer some hope and comfort to people. When this show first debuted in 2016, I wanted to hate it. This is a show about suicide and grief, and the impact of mental health on our communities. I wanted to hate this show. But it has actually been one of the most healing things for my recovery journey. And I pray it will be healing for you as well. Friends, there are 2 definitions for the term survivor of suicide. 1, you yourself have attempted suicide and lived. 2, a close friend or family member of yours died by suicide. I claim both of those definitions. This is a club that nobody wants to be in. And if you are in this club with me, I am holding you in my heart right now through this service and as we come out on the other side. Friends, this is a topic that is difficult and makes people uncomfortable. And it is vital that we talk about it from the pulpit and in sanctuaries and in faith communities, because after my attempt 17 years ago, no one in my church knew how to talk to me. No one knew how to be there for my family. It was painful. Now, not everyone has that experience. Some survivors of suicide are comforted and held by their faith communities, and I am so thankful for that. But as long as there are people who feel isolated and hurt, I actually feel that it would be spiritual malpractice to not speak about this as a Christian pastor. So, take care of yourself during this service. Take a deep breath. If you need to talk after the service is over, I am here. This church is here for you. We see you, we love you, and we are here to remind you that you are never alone. Let us take a deep breath and remember that there's nothing that can ever separate us from the love of God. Friends, let us pray. God, you are the God of our past, our present, and our future. You have walked with our ancestors. You will continue to walk with us and our descendants. We know that you created this world as an act of love, and that each and every one of us was created in your own image. And so we, therefore, are just walking images of love. On this day, God, we pray for our community. Continued prayers for Joan and Denny Hopper as Denny continues to heal and recover after his heart surgery last week. God, we pray for comfort and care for the Bossler family as they mourn the death of Twyla Daniels, wife of Dean and mother of Beth. And prayers surrounding that family as Beth and Chris's son, Rob, was married this weekend. Through all of their different emotions, we ask for your love to surround them. God, we also ask for prayers of comfort for the family of Helen Silchenko, who died last week, and especially for her grandson, Joseph. God, we lift up Gwen Lewis, who is mourning the loss of her sister-in-law, her late husband Woody's last sibling. God, in the midst of loss and confusion, we also lift up our joys to you, and especially the joy of Leo Arthur Souza's birth, who is the son of Hannah Stoller and Igor Souza, and we celebrate with Leo's proud grandparents, Chuck and Sherry Stoller. God, we also ask that you would surround Maya Thompson, who will be traveling to Germany this week, where they will be embarking on a study abroad year. Prayers of strength and love for the entire Thompson-Smith family and traveling mercies for Reverend Erica as she makes the trip with Maya this week. God, hear all of these prayers of our community. God, we also pray for those of us who feel like there's something missing today. Whether that feeling comes from missing a person we thought would still be here, or we're just feeling off. We mourn the loss of dreams for the future and are working each day to make sense of where the path is heading. Empower us to know it's okay to miss things, but also to remember that we have the opportunity to be resurrected each morning and have the chance to make something beautiful out of the new paths and new journeys. Even when things don't look the way we thought they would, you are with us and are cheering us on and holding our hand. God, we also ask that you would show us how to love in these overwhelming times so that we can be the people you called us to be. We know that love can be messy. Love isn't just one thing, it's fierce and soft, intimate and collective, wild and sincere and just. Love can sometimes be more chaos than order. Love can also be a boundary. It's complicated. Love can be hard work, but love is also the most natural thing in the world. So God, continue to be with us as we grow into loving our neighbors more fully, so that we can bring about your kingdom here on earth. Let us draw our hearts together as we pray aloud the prayer your Son taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So as I said before, we put out this call for backpacks really not that long ago. It was only a few weeks ago, and when we first heard that they needed 200 backpacks, we were a little nervous, wondering if we, especially in the summer, would be able to collect that many. I have to tell you, you all reminded us that this is an incredible congregation, and that when you are asked to rise to the occasion, you do it, because you know that this is important ministry. Today, as we move into a time of offering, I invite you to think about the things that have been placed on your heart, the things that you feel are needed in the world, and I ask that you find a way to give of yourself so that we as a church can continue rising to the occasion to care for our neighbors. Let us give back to God a small portion of what has been so graciously given to us.
To slam on the brake before I even turn the key, before I make the mistake, before I lead with the worst of me. Give them no reason to stare, no slipping up if you slip away. So I got nothing to share, no, I got nothing to say. Step out of the sun if you keep getting burned. Step out of the sun because you've learned. On the outside, always looking in, will I ever be more than I've always been? Cause I'm tapping on the glass. So I wait around for an answer to appear while I'm watching people pass. I'm waving through a window. Can anybody see? Is anybody waving back at me? Start with stars in our eyes. We start believing that we belong, but every sun doesn't rise, and no one tells you where you went wrong. Step out of the sun if you keep getting burned. Step out of the sun because you've learned. On the outside, always looking in, will I ever be more than I've always been? Because I'm tapping on the glass, waving through a window. I try to speak, but nobody can hear. So I wait around for an answer to appear as I'm watching people pass, waving through a window. Can anybody see? Is anybody waving? When you're falling in a forest and there's nobody around, do you ever really crash or even make a sound? When you're falling in a forest and there's nobody around, do you ever really crash or even make a sound? When you're falling in a forest and there's nobody around, do you ever really crash or even make a sound? When you're falling in a forest and there's nobody around, do you ever really crash or even make a sound? Did I even make a sound? Did I even make a sound? It's like I never made a sound. Will I ever make a sound? On the outside, always looking in, will I ever be more than I've always been? Cause I'm tapping on the glass, waving through a window. I try to speak, but nobody can hear. So I wait around for an answer to appear as I'm watching people pass, waving through a window. Is anybody waving? Whoa.
Gracious God, take these gifts and make sure everybody knows how much we love them. Amen. You may be seated.
Do not feel lonely. The entire universe is inside you. Stop acting small. You are the universe in ecstatic motion. Set your life on fire. See those who fan your flame.
Today's scripture reading is from Luke 8:16-18. No one, after lighting a lamp, hides it under a jar or puts it under a bed. Rather, one puts it on a lampstand so that those who enter may see the light. For nothing is hidden that will not be disclosed, nor anything secret that will become known and come to light. So pay attention to how you listen. For those who have, more will be given. And from those who do not have, even what they seem to have will be taken away. And from Psalm 139:13-16, for it is you who form me in my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works that I know very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes behold my unformed substance. In your book you've written all the days that were formed for me, when none of them as yet existed. Thanks be for the word of God. Amen.
Will you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, be with us as we try to make sense of your word so that we can be more loving people. Amen. So friends, I am not a betting person, but if I were, I would be willing to bet that when people first see me, they assume that I have a pretty wild and crazy lifestyle. And once people hear that I'm a pastor's daughter, they think they've got this all figured out. And I guess sometimes, if people meet me in the context of church, it's assumed that I used to have a pretty wild and crazy lifestyle. The most common questions strangers ask me, and this litany of questions literally just happened this past week on my flight back from California, so get ready. Here are the questions. Pointing to one of my tattoos, did that hurt? Which leads to the second question, what kind of job do you have? And then sometimes after telling them that no, I'm not a hairdresser, tattoo artist, or piercer, that I'm an ordained Christian minister, they either cock their head to the side or lean in and say, really? Or, oh, when did you become a Christian? Or when did you convert to Christianity? I kid you not, as if I couldn't have possibly been a Christian the whole time and come out looking like this. Now, there's so much more to unpack about that, but for today, let me just paint you a little picture of how real life teenage Jordan lived. Because it's not at all that exciting. Growing up, I was generally asleep before my parents even told me to go to bed, and would sometimes fall asleep while we were still out, like in a restaurant or a theater, like straight up, curled up asleep in a booth. At 14, you can call my parents, they've got plenty of stories. I was like the only kid in the world who didn't need a curfew because I just wanted to go to sleep early anyway. I wasn't that kind of pastor's daughter. I loved going to church. I was genuinely excited to go volunteer for events, go on mission trips, finally be a part of the confirmation class. And my first real job that I applied for on the day I turned 15 was working in the dining room at a nursing home, and I loved it. Friends, I begged my parents to buy me all of the books. I couldn't get enough books. Wild and crazy, right? While other teens were out doing teen things, on most Friday or Saturday nights, you could find me either at home or at my version of Mecca. The giant four-story tall Barnes and Noble at Newport on the Levee in Newport, Kentucky, right over the Ohio River from Cincinnati. It was one of the first places I knew to have a Starbucks. So on any given weekend, you could find me and my two best friends sipping on Frappuccinos and flipping through a mountain of books. It was amazing, because I know how to have a good time. So it was during one of those exciting, over-caffeinated evenings, sitting on the questionable carpet of a bookstore, that I discovered something called post-secret. Now, if you are my age, you probably know exactly what this is. But if you've never heard of it, it's okay. Here's the gist. Post Secret is a community art project started by Frank Warren in 2005. The concept of the project was that completely anonymous people decorate a postcard to portray a secret that they have never previously revealed. No restrictions are made on the content of the secret, only that it must be completely truthful and must never have been spoken before. Over the years, Warren would post these secrets he received on a blog and in art displays at various venues around the world. Now, I came to discover Post Secret because over the years, thousands of these anonymous secrets have been published in books, so that anyone who wanted could literally hold these anonymous secrets in their hands whenever they wanted. Now, they range from silly confessions and bad habits to actual misconduct and infidelity, all the way to heartbreaking realizations about a person's life. Here are some examples so you get an idea. My boyfriend complains that I like the dog more than him. He's right. I actually do. Or, I believe I will accomplish something truly great in my lifetime. I'm gonna be 53 tomorrow. And I leave poetry in library books. Or how about these? I steal from every doctor's office I visit, even things that I'll never use. Or, dear stranger, you saw me crying at the airport. Thank you for understanding, for caring, for giving me hope on the loneliest day of my life. I won't forget. To this, I'm still in love with her. I hope she reads this and recognizes my handwriting. This is also my last try. Folks, there are thousands of these, and I've read literally all of them. And, no surprise, but my favorite collection of secrets are the ones about religion. And many of them can be found in the book Post Secret: Confessions on Life, Death, and God. So here are a few of those secrets. I go shopping on Sunday mornings because everyone else is at church. Sometimes I wish I didn't believe, so I could stop feeling like I'm just disappointing him. Dear God, will you still love me if I believe in evolution? My boyfriend won't. How about this? I wish I could be a lesbian and still go to heaven. I make up sin so that I can go to confessional and shock the priest. I'm so afraid God is sexist. Since 2005, I have religiously followed Post Secret on its online blog and have purchased each gorgeous and heartbreaking physical volume that's published. Because to me, this community art project is the embodiment of an invitation to being our authentic selves, and what it means to share or not share with the world who we truly are. It's a portal into the secrets of humanity, some good, some bad, but all important if we are to understand what it means to be human. And I believe that reading these secrets can actually make us feel less alone. There is power in the sacred solidarity of being allowed into others' hearts. Because, folks, we all have secrets. We all have secrets or things that we're afraid to reveal to the world. We're afraid of being judged or hurting people. Or maybe the lie that we've told has just gone on for so long that it now feels out of control. And that is exactly at the core of our musical for this morning, Dear Evan Hansen. As I said before, Dear Evan Hansen follows the story of a young teen who suffers from depression and anxiety. At the advice of his therapist, he begins writing motivational letters to himself every day to help him think positive thoughts. And each letter begins, "Dear Evan Hansen." The show opens with Evan writing one of these letters to get him ready for the first day of school. He recently broke his arm over the summer after falling out of a tree, and his mom suggests that maybe he can get some of his friends at school to sign his cast. The problem is, Evan doesn't have any friends. His anxiety always gets in the way of any human connection. But as fate would have it, while fumbling anxiously and awkwardly through the day, Evan bumps into another student, Connor Murphy. Now, Connor is known for being a little rough around the edges and a little scary. So Connor, in jest, signs Evan's cast in big block letters as to intimidate and mock. He then steals the motivational letter Evan had written for himself that morning. Oh my God, Evan is mortified. This is a nightmare. How embarrassing that someone else now possesses one of these Dear Evan Hansen letters. Oh, so now he's thinking, I bet Connor is gonna have a field day with this information and get everyone else to make fun of me. The anxiety goes into hyperdrive. Fast forward. A few days later, Evan is called out of class and into the principal's office. When he arrives, Connor Murphy's parents are there. They seem sad and a little upset. Evan's afraid he's in trouble. Then Connor's parents say that their son has died. He killed himself. and they believe that his suicide note was written for Evan. Because it begins, "Dear Evan Hansen." Oh God, the letter that Connor stole was on him when he died, so his parents assume Connor wrote it for Evan. Panic is setting in. He thinks he's about to get busted. Then they see Connor written on his cast, and Mrs. Murphy smiles and says, "Evan, we're just so glad to know that Connor had a friend." Oh, Connor's parents think that they were friends, which was not at all true. But with this look of hope and relief in their eyes, they explain that they just want to ask him some questions so they can know more about their friendship, because it's the last thing they have of their son. And so, Evan goes along with the lie, keeps the truth a secret, creating this whole story about his and Connor's friendship, tales of adventures they had together, climbing trees, talking about girls, dreaming about the future together. All lies. But as the story spreads, he loves the attention he's getting from not only Connor's family, but the whole school. His classmates are paying attention to him. So he tells more stories. The lie becomes bigger and bigger, and his increasingly dramatic falsehoods get out of hand when they hit the internet, complicating everything and leading to all of these fabricated fables to come to light. And in the end, everyone discovers that Evan was lying the whole time, hurting everyone in the process. Folks, this is a hard show to watch, if I'm being honest. The lying, the deceit, and the ways in which we see grief from so many different angles. Most of the time, when people hear loss or grieving, they imagine someone just lying in bed crying. That's not actually what grief looks like. We know that. Connor's parents' grief looks like overperforming and staying busy as to not to deal with their son's death. Connor's sister's grief looks like anger. She's pissed at her brother. He was never even that nice to her when he was alive, and now everyone's thinking of him as this incredible guy just because he died. And Evan's grief, as he begins to really unpack his depression and his unresolved feelings around his own father, and how all of this attention makes him realize that he's never actually acknowledged how much pain he's been in for years. Friends, near the end of the show, he eventually confesses to his mom that his broken arm, the cast that Connor Murphy signed, was actually the result of his own suicide attempt. Friends, the thing that people actually don't like about this show is that it doesn't totally resolve at the end. But that's actually what I have grown to love about it. Because just like in life, the pieces aren't picked up and put in the correct place by the time the curtain closes. Once everyone learns that Evan was lying, there's some chaos, but really that's when the real healing can begin. Because healing isn't linear, ever, right? It's messy, it's unpredictable, but it also always relies on telling the truth. By the end of the show, Evan Hansen realizes that many of the lessons Connor's death taught him, something that was actually in him all along. He had just spent so much time stifling it for fear that people just wouldn't get it. But secrets and lying don't ever make things better. They just hide them for a little while. And if that's not the most human truth, then I actually don't know what I'm doing up here. Getting it all out in the open hurts like hell at first. But it eventually helped save Evan and begin the real healing process for an entire community. Friends, all three of our readings this morning are each a facet of the truth of dear Evan Hansen, and really, Christianity itself. Here they are. Things hurt in life, but you are amazing, and loved, and fearfully and wonderfully made. Don't hide your light, whatever you do. Learn how to lift people up, because everyone freaking needs it. Things hurt in life, but you are amazing and loved and fearfully made. Don't hide your light, whatever you do, and learn how to lift people up, because everyone freaking needs it. Our sacred scripture readings today that Sean read for us are super familiar to most people who have been around church. The psalmist tells us that God knows us and that we are unique and crafted with love by the Creator. It's a classic for a reason. And our gospel reading is from the infamous salt and light speech by Jesus, who tells us that it is so silly, I'm paraphrasing, it is so silly to light a lamp and then stick it under something like a jar or a bed or a basket, because obviously that makes no sense, right? That would hide your light from the world. But to me, it's more than just hiding your light. It's actually a question of how we as people extinguish the light by denying it what it naturally needs. Hold that. We'll come back to it in a minute. Finally, our third text that Maya so beautifully read comes from the 13th century Persian poet, Islamic scholar, and Sufi mystic Rumi, and is one of my favorite reminders and calls in the world. Let's listen to it again. Do not feel lonely. The entire universe is inside of you. Stop acting small. You are the universe in ecstatic motion. Set your life on fire. Seek those who fan your flames. I mean, how gorgeous is that? And the whole thing is beautiful, but it is actually the last line of that text that makes my heart skip a beat and makes me cry. Set your life on fire and seek those who fan your flames. Now listen, fire is one of those things that totally terrifies and fascinates me. At first glance, it seems destructive and alarming. Stop, drop, and roll. Smoke alarms going off. Get out of the house. Scary fire. So while that is true, fire is also vital to our world. And the control of fire literally changed humanity. Fire provided a source of warmth and lighting, protection from predators, especially at night. It was a way to create more advanced hunting tools, a method for cooking food. I mean, these cultural advances allowed human geographic dispersal, cultural innovations and changes to diet. And while Listen, you will never see me trying to, like, start a fire. I'm what you might call indoorsy. But I do know the holy trinity of what fire needs. Heat, fuel, and oxygen. Heat, fuel, and oxygen. And if Rumi is right, and we are fiery flames with the most gorgeous pyrotechnic potential inside of each of us, it seems that the holy trinity of what we need is warmth, passion, and breath. Warmth, passion, and breath. Friends, even our sacred Genesis creation myth tells us that what made humans human was God literally breathing into us. That the most holy thing that we do every day, one of the ways that we draw closer to the divine, is just breathing. That's all you have to do to draw close to God. So friends, fanning our flames, breathing, is a reminder that we get to be co-creators with the divine. Friends, you are fearfully and wonderfully made. Breathe. This Rumi text is a divine invitation, and it reminds us to go remind everyone else we meet about this truth. Do not feel lonely. The entire universe is inside of you. Stop acting small. You are the universe in ecstatic motion. Set your life on fire and seek those who fan your flames. This is sacred work. It's one of the ways that we reveal God to each other. Because friends, we all need warmth, passion, and breath. But let's get back to that gospel reading. If all of that is true, hiding the light doesn't just relegate it to the shadows. Friends, it actually puts it at risk of being extinguished. That is what's at stake here. Secrets and shame, I believe, are flame destroyers. Flame extinguishers. I actually think that's what Jesus was saying to us. Don't light your lamp and then hide it from the world, because you're actually just denying all of us a glimpse into the divine. We bring our light out of the darkness so that we can see the truth of who everyone is. Even if it's messy, or you think it's damaged or dimmer, you are the universe in ecstatic motion, and your flame deserves to be fanned by the world. Now listen, I have so many things that I want to say to you all, and if you need to talk more about this, please reach out to me after the service. Either find me, email me, I'm here. But for right now, I am just going to take this moment to share with you all just one of the ways that my flame has been fanned by my loved ones over the past 17 years since my own suicide attempt. The American Foundation for Suicide Prevention is one of the most incredible organizations. If you don't know them, please look them up. They have resources and support for just about anything you could ever need when it comes to understanding, preventing, and mourning suicide. But it's not just about statistics. It's about being a community so that no one ever feels alone. Each year, thousands of people from across the country participate in what are called Out of the Darkness walks. In AFSP's community, campus, and overnight walks, those who have been affected by suicide and those who support them raise awareness and much-needed funds. But most importantly to me, it's an opportunity to be with other people who understand. Since 2012, every year, my mom and I have walked in these Out of the Darkness walks together. Sometimes with a bigger team, sometimes it's just the two of us, and sometimes it's over the phone because we now live in different states. I also participate in World Suicide Prevention Day, which is September 10th, by the way, and organizations like To Write Love on Our Arms have yearly themes. I own every single shirt that they have ever made. I wear them all the time. And it simultaneously helps me feel less alone, and in my everyday life, it actually helps me connect with other people. Sometimes people ask me questions about what the shirts mean, or they recognize them, because they have the same thing. But the most important thing about all of this is that it reminds me that the darkness doesn't have to win. Sometimes it feels like it does. I know that. And so in those moments, we are called to remind people of these truths. Do you remember them? Things hurt in life, but you are amazing and loved and fearfully and wonderfully made. Don't hide your light, whatever you do. And learn how to lift people up, because everyone freaking needs it. The things that are placed over our light, whether we put them there or our life circumstances have, they don't have to stay there. It's our job as people of faith to lift those things off and breathe light and love onto each other. Friends, that's Christianity. That's the gospel. And that's the whole point of Dear Evan Hansen. Now, I have struggled with how to end this sermon, so I'm gonna take a page out of the Dear Evan Hansen playbook and allow loose ends to not be tied up. This conversation needs to keep going. So for this morning, I am going to allow our final song to be the conclusion of the sermon. Listen to the words. Feel the message. No matter what, you are loved and worthy of everything good. And when you are lost, we will find you. Amen.
Have you ever felt like nobody was there? Have you ever felt forgotten in the middle of nowhere? Have you ever felt like you could disappear? Like you could fall and no one would hear?
So let the lonely feeling wash away, 'cause maybe there's a reason to believe you'll be okay. 'Cause when you don't feel strong enough to stand, you can reach out your hand. And
someone will come running, and I know they'll take you home. Even when the dark comes crashing through, when you need a friend to carry you, and when you're broken on the ground, you will be found. So let the sun come streaming in, 'cause you'll reach up and you'll rise again. Lift your head and look around, you will be found. You will be found.
Friends, stories are powerful. They show us truth and reveal the meaning of our world. Our stories are sacred. They reveal how God is moving in our midst. We are changed by their telling and their hearing. Stories are one of the ways Jesus taught, because he knew how they touched and inspired. May we go out into the world today knowing that our stories are meant to be used to show the world more about God. We are bringing about the kingdom of God every time we share and listen. May it be so. Amen.